Good morning, class. Good morning, Mr. Sleep. Hey, everybody. It's Monday. I think it's like the 16th of November. And if you're watching this, you were unable to make the class today, or I said something really confusing. Either way, I hope everything's great with you. Hope you're doing well, and hope everyone around you is doing well. Hope you didn't blow away yesterday in the wind. Oh my goodness, that was crazy. Guess it's just that time of year. I mean, where it's going to be a little weird for like 4 or 5 months. Anyway, I'm going to run you through everything that we did today in class and make sure that you're up to speed on what's going on and what this week is going to look like. So first, obviously we did trivia in class. Do that every day at the start. But then some reminders. First of all, you had a quiz that we took on Friday last week. I'm working on those, getting those in the gradebook. I'll have them in the gradebook later today. If you didn't take that yet, the link for the quiz is actually listed in last Friday's in case you missed it. So make sure you take a look at that, take that. Shouldn't take you too long, and you can use your notes on it. Other reminders, this is another full week. I apologize for that. I did everything I could to try to make sure it didn't happen, but you know, what are you going to do? Oh, if you didn't hand your assignment in last week, the reconstruction overview, you've got until, well, get it done. Just get it in. You're dragging behind. You're killing me. Anyway, this week, basically what the goal is we're going to finish up reconstruction on Wednesday, taking a test on Wednesday. That's going to be Wednesday's class. Thursday, we're going to get started on the West, and I'm going to give you a new assignment on Thursday. You got a new assignment today on reconstruction. I'll have a new assignment on the West on Thursday. That new assignment on the West won't be due until next Tuesday night, which will actually be the last day before Thanksgiving break. Other than that, here we go. So today, what we're going to do is we're going to look at Grant's terms as president. We're not going to go into real deep detail on that because, well, you know, it's not that important to our overall story of what we're trying to talk about. And then we're going to begin looking at kind of life in the South. I'm going to give you some work time on the new assignment. Keep prepping for Wednesday's test. Now, what I mean by prepping is just making sure that you're paying attention in class and also, you know, making sure you have all the notes. If you missed any days in class, go back to that date in the in case you missed it in classroom and, you know, get those notes down. Wednesday's test is going to be all short essays. There's going to be five questions. You pick three. And then if you want to get a four, you have to do, there's like an optional level four question. So, all right. Well, without further ado, here we go. So that's Ulysses S. Grant. Obviously, well, I hope, obviously, gains a great deal of popularity in the North and with the freedmen as the victorious general in the Civil War. And you know, back then, a lot of our former presidents were, you know, had a lot of mil had military experience and were war heroes. It seemed to be a good way to gain notoriety in the country back then. So in 1868, Johnson's disappointing term as president ends. I'm not saying that a lot didn't get done. Congress got a lot done. That whole radical Reconstruction, military Reconstruction idea, the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments are in place. The Freedmen's Bureau did its work for a little while, but there's just as many things that didn't get done that could have gotten done because of Johnson and Congress's difficulties. Well, in 1868, Grant runs as the Republican candidate for president. And he wins in a landslide. If you don't know what that means he wins by a lot. And I don't think it was surprising that the Republican candidate won because obviously Lincoln had been a Republican. Many of the Southerners still couldn't vote, so their odds of getting a Democrat elected were pretty low. But one of the major reasons why Grant won and was able to win so big is because the 15th Amendment gave African American men the right to vote. And about, I think the numbers is somewhere around 500,000, so 500,000 or so African American men are able to vote for the first time. And it's a logical pick that they would vote for Grant. He overwhelmingly wins the black male vote, and that helps, you know, propel him to the presidency. Grant's two terms as president are they're productive. I mean, a lot gets done. Things start to move in a slightly better direction. Some of the states get readmitted in the South. But one of the big struggles that he had was that he obviously gets to name people to important positions. If you're the president, you're naming the president's cabinet, you're naming other under offices. And one of the difficulties that Grant had as president was that he, rather than naming always the most qualified people, he often named people that he knew, people who helped get him elected, which was very common back then. Unfortunately, those advisors did not do well by him. They either didn't do their jobs well, didn't give him good advice, or worse, there was some corruption. There were a couple of instances of Grant's officials that he named swindling the government or ripping the government off out of money or ripping taxpayers off out of money. Now, Grant himself, all the evidence is Grant himself never got any money out of that, but it makes you look bad when the people around you make bad choices. So the lesson to be learned from Grant is always look for the most qualified people, not necessarily the people you know. And during Grant's term, kind of the biggest thing that he was always fighting against was the culture of the South. This idea that even though the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments existed, Southern states were going to do anything they could to hold Black people down, that they were going to develop systems, laws, cultural norms that people would live by that would make it hard for Black people to succeed in the South. And obviously that poor advice that he was getting from other people slowed down the process and made things more difficult. One of the big things that Grant had going on his side is there were a lot of people, obviously, that wanted to see the South succeed. There were a lot of people that wanted to see the South come back and the country reunite. And some of those people were some of the new leaders in the South. For instance, there were a number of Black men like Hiram Revels who got involved in Southern leadership. As soon as African-American men could vote, obviously it goes hand in hand that Black men are going to be elected to positions of importance. You had, like, for instance, I think it was South Carolina where the Black voters actually outnumber the white voters. But, you know, you have everything from mayors to, you know, county elected officials and things like that who are having an impact on local and state society and trying to pass laws and do things that will benefit Black society and Black communities in the South. But three other groups of people kind of pop up. Two, I think, that Grant would have considered to be beneficial in a way, and one that was definitely a problem as things went on. The first one I'm going to talk about are carpetbaggers. Now, that might seem like an odd term, and I think it is. I think this is the only place that ever pops up. And the reason I'm teaching you it, though, is because when we're talking about power and power in the South and who sets the terms of how things are going, carpetbaggers played a role. Now, the reason they're called carpetbaggers is they're Northerners who move South to help or scam people. We'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. And often back then, if you've ever seen the pictures of the people where they have the stick over their shoulder and they have the small bag made out of like fabric or material, they called those people carpetbaggers. They also made like suitcases out of chunks of carpet. Generally speaking, a lot of Northerners went South to try to help. There were teachers who left their schools and opened schools to help needy whites and the freed Blacks learn to read and write. There were doctors who left the North to help with medical care. There were ministers and priests and preachers who went down South and opened churches to try to teach religion throughout the South. Some of those people who went North got involved in went South, got involved in the government and tried to, you know, replicate some of the things that were happening in the North as far as a closer version to equality. However, there were some Northerners who went down South to rip people off, to see it as an opportunity to take money away from people. Obviously, you know, people were desperate in the South for something better. And when someone's desperate, it's easy to separate them from their money more quickly, dishonestly. And some carpetbaggers did that. Scalawags also played a role in the government. Now, scalawag is a term that you do hear every once in a while, usually here in pirate movies. So if you've seen like Pirates of the Caribbean, you've probably heard the term before. It actually, the word means traitor, like
traitor, like you like you're stabbing someone in the back and going with the enemy. They were Southerners who went along with what the North wanted to do. Now, a number of them went along with what the North wanted to do because they agreed with it. They thought from a general life thing, it was probably a better way to do things. Some went along with what the North wanted to do because they wanted power. They saw this as an opportunity to better their situation, and whether or not they really wanted to do what the North wanted to do kind of popped up later in things. Last, and I'm going to go with definitely least, were the Redeemers. Now, if you know that word, redeem means to regain something or make up for something past. And basically, Redeemers were Southerners who wanted the South to be like it was before the war, you know, obviously minus slavery because the 13th Amendment abolished that. When they got into power, their goal was to return to the old ways. Their two major goals for the Redeemers were white supremacy and to try to boost the economy of the South. So they wanted to have money and they wanted white power. Now, I know you're thinking about this and going, well, why would the North let those people get back into power? Well, it's not necessarily that they let them get back into power. It's that people started to vote for them. And then toward the end of Reconstruction, they play a pretty significant role. Now, that's going to be it for today, note-wise. Now, what we're going to do tomorrow is we're going to go through three slides and we're going to wrap things up and prepare you guys for the test. Now, again, you know, be reviewing through things. We've talked about a lot of things. In a way, it seems a little disjointed, but trust me, it all goes together. If you have any questions, please make sure and let me know, and I'd be more than happy to help you out. Make sure and take a look at that assignment that I have loaded in the classroom, and if you have any issues about how that works or what to do with it, please let me know. Actually, you know what? I'm going to take a second. I'm going to show you guys that quick. The assignment that I loaded for you guys is called a thing link. Sorry, it's a little slow sometimes here. All right, Reconstruction and Race in the South. Now, I don't know if it's going to do it this time with me. Okay, so you've got a series of questions that go along with this link here. This link takes you to a thing called a thing link. When I clicked on it this morning, it was really small, and I'm not sure why that's the case. Let's see if it happens again. Yeah, really small. So I'm going to magnify. Okay, now you'll see this picture on my screen, and you'll notice that on it there are some dots. You've got this play button, which will take you to a small video about the Black Codes. You've got this brief history of the KKK in simple Wikipedia. I don't know if you know there's simple Wikipedia. Thing about Jim Crow laws, a thing about, it says it's an Instagram thing, but it's not. Race and voting in the segregated South, Black Codes in Mississippi. Don't worry about this black one. The black one doesn't do anything. And these are going to take you to the various articles and videos that you need to answer the questions on here. So, for instance, it says in the early years of the KKK, what groups of people served as primary targets? So if I go to the thing link and I'm like, oh, which one of these is about the KKK? Oh, it's that one. I click on it. It's going to take me to a short article. Again, simple Wikipedia is really pretty sweet if you didn't know that existed. And I can read through the first paragraph and you're gonna find that answer there. So again, you're gonna use this picture. If for some reason it doesn't pop up, I may post the links along with this to make sure that you guys get what you need. Otherwise, if you have questions, please make sure and let me know. Reach out. I'm here to help. I will see you soon. Bye.